Hey everyone, my name is Eric Michaud. I'm a PhD student here in the physics department. And my research in general sort of focuses on trying to get a better understanding of machine learning systems sort of for their own sake, and sort of treating deep neural networks as just intrinsically interesting objects of study. It's this kind of interesting situation right now in the world where like our scientific understanding of the systems is maybe behind our ability to do engineering on them, maybe comparable to how people could build steam engines without sort of our modern understanding of thermodynamics. And so, you know, you might wonder what we might discover in trying to get a better understanding of the systems and maybe understand something about the world in the process of doing this. And I'll be talking today just briefly about this recent preprint from our group, the Quantization Model of Neural Scaling. And in this paper, we were interested in, trying to understand, how can we think about the difference between what large neural networks and small neural networks learn? And just more generally, what effect does scaling have on what neural networks learn? And there's this kind of remarkable predictability to this difference, right, between small and large neural networks. In that, sort of in the aggregate, like the mean error, the mean test loss of these systems decreases predictably as a power law in the amount of data that they're trained on and the size of the networks. And so we'd like to understand where these power laws come from. And through our model for this, we call it the quantization model. And we were sort of inspired by some physics history in sort of Planck's resolution of the ultraviolet catastrophe, where he sort of assumes that maybe there's this kind of underlying discreteness to the states that particles in the system could take. And then this allowed him to sort of get the right smooth black body radiation curve. And here we're going to assume that there's similarly a kind of underlying discreteness to what neural networks learn. And then we're going to show that we can recover this kind of smooth scaling laws and sort of averaging over a large number of discrete changes in what neural networks learn. And so the basic assumptions that we make in the model are that maybe to do prediction well on something like natural language, there are just a bunch of sort of discrete things you need to learn, like pieces of knowledge about language or about the world, or computations that sort of you need to learn how to implement internally if you're a neural network and you're going to do prediction well. And we're going to assume that these are discrete in the sense that sort of each one of these pieces of knowledge or pieces of computation can be thought of as either having been learned or not having been learned by a neural network. And we're going to call these the quanta of the prediction problem. And next, we're going to sort of assume that some of these things are going to be more useful for prediction than others. So you might think that basic grammatical rules are going to be sort of very frequently useful for predicting text on the internet. And so sort of not understanding them is going to be very costly. But maybe very infrequently or something do you need to understand very esoteric physics to do prediction well of words on the internet. So if you're only going to learn one thing, better to learn grammatical rules than esoteric physics. But if you have a big enough network, maybe you'll eventually learn the physics, because there are situations where that is useful for prediction. And lastly, we're going to assume that the frequencies at which these pieces of knowledge, these quanta, are useful for prediction follow a power law. And we can see how this gives us power law scaling in the following way. If you just consider the change in the mean loss, the mean error that comes from sort of learning an additional one of these quanta, if it is useful for prediction on some fraction f sub k of samples for quantum k, and it lowers loss on average on those examples by some amount, then just the amount that learning that piece of knowledge, that quanta, lowers your mean loss is just proportional to that frequency. And so if the frequencies follow a power law, then how much, or sort of what is your loss as a function of how many you learn, you can basically just integrate under the like curve of how much you reduce loss from learning each of like the first n of these things, and sort of integrating under a power law gives us a power law where we go from a power law in frequency with x1 and alpha plus 1 to a power law in loss as a function of the number of these quanta that you learn with x1 and alpha. And you can translate this into power laws in the number of network parameters or the number of data points. You know, in this way, for instance, if you just assume that, you know, on average, each one of these quanta requires some amount of network capacity, then for a network of a finite size, you can only learn so many, and the number of quanta you can learn, you can fit in your network, is going to be proportional then to the size of the network, and so then you get a power law in parameters. And you can do, you should give similar arguments for data. So that's the model. Just briefly, I'll show that it is possible to like construct data sets where this model of scaling is true. So I won't really describe exactly what we did. You can check out the paper for this. But basically, we just described this sort of binary classification problem on binary strings, where there are a bunch of sort of subsets of the data, where doing prediction on each of those subsets requires you know, different features to be learned by the network. And then when we sort of impose this power law distribution over how frequently samples are seen in the data from each of these subsets, we get power law scaling in the mean loss. But this power law is sort of averaging over a large number of these sort of discrete transitions as the network sort of learns how to do prediction well on subsets of the data. And basically, larger networks sort of learn how to do prediction well on sort of more and more of these subsets of the data. And so we see indeed that like the smooth power laws on top sort of average over like a large number of these sort of discrete changes, which you can see on the bottom. So at least with data with the right structure, this sort of model can hold. But then you might just wonder whether this is like the right model for language data. And it does seem like the story is a little bit more complicated. So for instance, when you look at scaling curves on individual samples for large language models. So you have, you know, here I'm showing curves for models of different sizes. You know, they've been trained on the same amount of data here. So we're just looking at parameter scaling, and then just looking at the model's loss on an individual prediction problem. So predicting a particular word from a particular document from a large corpus of documents from the internet, and you can basically just you know, look at these large number of scaling curves on individual examples. The sort of overall mean of these is a power law, but individually do they look like power laws? Well, we can find curves that look more discrete. And like, if you look at what prediction involves here, it's like, oh, predicting someone's name or something. So here, this requires a sort of maybe more discrete knowledge. You either know the name or you don't. Or predicting what company someone works for. So it is possible to find these sort of like discrete scaling curves. But you also find other scaling curves which looks more smooth. So I guess like if we're gonna sort of believe our theory, then maybe what's going on in these samples is that sort of many of these quanta are improving the model's prediction a little bit, and they're being learned at different scales, leading to more gradual scaling. The idea here is like maybe similar to how in biological organisms, there's some large number of genes that they have, and then for any particular trait, there's like some smaller number of those genes which are relevant to influencing that trait. Maybe there's sort of these large number of quanta that are present in the model. And then for any given prediction problem of predicting the next token, one or many of the quanta could be relevant. So we call these sort of monogenic versus polygenic prediction problems. Lastly, I'll just say, you know, can we actually discover what these sort of pieces of knowledge are for doing language modeling, for doing language prediction? So what are the quanta for language modeling? And what are the quanta inside large language models? The way that we proposed to do this was just clustering examples based on whether the model is a gradient on those samples pointed in a similar direction. And this worked surprisingly well. So we do get these very interesting clusters. It might be a little bit tricky to see, but like all of these examples which were clustered together involve like predicting like the next number in a numerical sequence. So here it's like continuing this list of chapters, or here it's like continuing this list in code. So I guess maybe the common piece of knowledge among all these examples is sort of knowing how to count or something. And then
here, these all involve predicting a new line in contexts where the text was like limited in line length. And so maybe the common piece of knowledge here for these samples was the model's ability to sort of count line lengths. And you can find just a large number of these examples of language model behaviors in this way. And so you might just hope, you know, this was still in a fairly small scale model, but eventually we might be able to like enumerate sort of all of these pieces of knowledge or something that the language models sort of have learned internally and then hope to sort of understand them mechanistically by understanding each of these ones. And then just lastly, you know, we measured the size of each of these clusters of examples, and it seems like maybe eventually they fall into a power law, but this is still fairly preliminary, and it'd be good to try to scale this up to much larger language models. Yeah, actually, I think that's all I'm gonna say. Thanks.